Hello and a very warm welcome to Great Clacton Parish and to our Sunday service. But as you can see, once again, not to St John's Church. In fact, I was hoping to film from one or two northern beautiful locations, but it hasn't quite worked out today. So I'm actually filming from inside our car. We're on a journey today. We are travelling back, having visited one of the summer camps, summer ventures that we support as a church. We've collected our son Daniel from there, and we are on our way back home again. And so last week we had a bit of a holiday club special on our online service. Today a little bit of a summer camp special. And we'll be praying especially for the different summer camps that are going on across the country at this time, and giving thanks for the one that we've just visited that our church has got a link with. You're very warmly welcomed. You should find that it's Sunday the 4th of August, if you're watching this as it premieres. If you're catching up later, you're also very warmly welcomed. And if you are watching this as it premieres, do take the opportunity to greet one another on the live chat or any other way that you can. As well as thinking about celebrating, giving thanks for summer camps and summer ventures, we also continue with our series in Mark's Gospel, the series that was inspired by our summer holiday club in St John's, following the same Bible passages, Bible stories that the children looked at. And today, as we go on a journey, on the roads with Jesus once more, we think about the time that the rich man came to see Jesus and what he said to the rich man. Maybe it's appropriate that as I film this, we're on a journey. We're on the journey back to Clacton from the Lake District where the summer camp was. But we especially think of Jesus being on his journey to Jerusalem and the folks that he met along the way. Once more, our hymns and songs are focused on the Lord Jesus. And we start by singing a great hymn together, one that Rachel leads us in. We're going to sing, "At the Name of Jesus, Every Knee Shall Bow." Let's sing together of the Lord Jesus. And then it's back to some pre-recorded material from St. John's Church, more normal setting, as we have our confession and our affirmation of faith.
Triumphant with its human.
During these weeks in August, we're taking the opportunity to use a few different confessions, different ways of reminding ourselves of our own need for forgiveness, how we have all turned away from God, and how we need, through Jesus, the cleansing, the washing, the forgiveness, and the reunion with the Lord that only Jesus can bring. And today's confession is based on the story that Jesus told, on the parable of the prodigal son, the lost son. And as we use this confession, we might like to remember that glorious welcome that the Father, in the story of the prodigal son, gave to the lost son when he came to his senses and turned back to his Father. We remember how the Father ran out to the son and welcomed him in with open arms. And that's a reminder of how much the Lord loves to forgive all those who turn round and turn back to him. Let's use these words on the screen to confess our sins. Let us return to the Lord our God and say to him, Father, we have sinned against heaven and against you. We are not worthy to be called your children. We turn to you again. Have mercy on us. Bring us back to yourself as those who were once dead, but now have life through Christ our Lord. Amen. The prayer, picking up words from that wonderful parable of the Lord Jesus. And if we have taken that opportunity to turn back to God, this prayer is for us. May the God of love bring us back to himself, forgive us our sins, and assure us of his eternal love in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And once more we sing a song that celebrates the forgiveness that we can know in the Lord Jesus.
To be healed from Israel that is healed. We usually use a creed or affirmation of faith in our services. And this week, an affirmation of faith that's based on Ephesians chapter 3. Let us declare our faith in God. We say together, we believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth was named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. We pray together the Lord's Prayer, praying for both our physical needs and our spiritual needs. And so we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Well, we return to our car studio for one or two notices at this stage. And just before that, it's worth saying that we usually choose a song to help us think about how wonderful the forgiveness, the cleansing, the washing that Jesus can bring us is. And we had that, what is often a children's song that we use sometimes in our services for our confession. A leper came to Jesus. Chose that one because we have been thinking about different people Jesus met. That story's from the first half of Mark's Gospel. And but it reminds us that just as Jesus could take away physical uncleanness, like leprosy was seen as, he can take away spiritual uncleanness as well. He can wash us clean from our sins. Another incident from Mark's Gospel reflected in that story a little bit earlier on, Mark chapter 1, for the leper who came to Jesus. But we do pause for one or two notices just now, and not very many of those at all at this time of year. Most of our things are taking a break over August, but one or two special things still going on. And one of those is happening this week, in that on Saturday the 10th, there's an extra coffee morning that Christine is running, and that's to raise money for a prostate cancer charity that she would like us to help support. So that's an extra coffee morning, Saturday the 10th. It's 9:30 to 11:30 as usual in the church hall. Do come along to that and support it if you can. And then next Sunday, services as usual, 9 o'clock at St John's, 10:30 at St Mark's, 11 o'clock here online. But as I say, a few fewer things happening during the week in August to give all our leaders of the different groups a bit of a break. However, we do have some birthdays today, quite a few birthdays to think about and to sing about and to celebrate. We've birthdays, including today, some of them for Mark, one of our Marks, Mark across in Birmingham, Tova, Jude, Keith, and Barry as well. So to Mark, Tova, Jude, Keith, and Barry, we sing together. Da 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 da. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Mark, Tova, Jude, Keith, and Barry. Happy birthday to you. Round of applause for them and anybody else with a birthday this week. Well, as I've said, we're on a journey. We're on a journey back from Cumbria. We've been visiting just last night and today, Friday night and Saturday. We've been visiting the Hope Cumbria Summer Venture. It's one of the CPAS ventures, CPAS summer camps that takes place each year. It's one that we've had a link with for many years as a church at St. John's and St. Mark's. And each year, some of our young people have gone on that venture. It started off based in Hope Valley in Derbyshire, but moved to Cumbria, and so got a bit of a mixed name of Hope Cumbria. And as you can probably see outside, we've had a lovely, lovely sunny week. One of the nicest weeks I think they've ever had in Cumbria for this time of year and for this camp. I think they've had one evening of heavy rain, but apart from that, it's been absolutely lovely. And we met some of the leaders and saw some of the things going on when we visited yesterday evening. And we've brought Daniel back, and he was the only person from St. John's and St. Mark's there this year. He was on the task force, the sort of young helpers group who helped run the camp. And he's had a great time. And what I thought we would do is just show a video. It's a video produced by CPAS to promote their summer camps, their summer ventures. You can see a bit of what's goes on, adventures across the country. And then we would take the opportunity to pray for them. And I think there's about 60 different ventures that go on each summer, and one or two at other times of the year across the country. They each have a leadership team, usually some sort of helpers, sort of university age, and then they cater for children from 11 to 18. Though some of the camps are a bit more specific about their age. It's often a mixture of fun activities. Maybe some of them have outward bound activities like the one in Cumbria does. And then as well, a chance to open up the Bible together and to learn about, especially about Jesus and what the Bible teaches about him. They're great for young people from Christian families. They're great for young people who are interested in finding out about the Christian faith as well. And we've very much appreciated the opportunity to be involved with them over the years. Some years we've had quite a few young people going, some years, just like this year, just one or two. But that's absolutely fine. And we hope to stay involved in supporting these summer ventures for many years to come. So on our summer venture special, summer camp special, this is our extra bit for today, and I hope you enjoy this short video showing some of the things that goes on at the CPAS summer camps.
It's the best way you could spend your summer.
It's really fun.
It's amazing. It's crazy.
It's fun.
It's like another family, and I'd recommend it to anyone.
All the activities are always really, really enjoyable.
Favourite activities so far, I really enjoyed crafts.
It's quite fun singing.
Paddleboarding.
It's one of the most life-changing things I've done.
Ventures is a great place to explore Christianity because you don't need to know anything about Jesus to come.
It just strengthens your faith while at the same time you're enjoying it as well.
The thing that brings me back is the leaders.
All the leaders are really nice.
Got some that will play sports with you and get really involved. Got others that if you want to just sit down and chat, they're happy to answer your questions and be really honest with you.
I think Ventures is one of the best places and I would recommend it to anyone.
So let's take this opportunity to pray for summer camps across the country. And especially for all that, give thanks for all that went on at Hope Cumbria. So Father God, we do thank you so much for the time and effort that goes on to organising these summer camps, summer ventures. We thank you, Lord, for especially for Hope Cumbria, for the good weather you blessed everybody with, for the fun week that was had, and the way the Bible was opened up and the Lord Jesus was taught about. We pray for each young person on the venture. We pray that they would go home having had a wonderful time filled with fun and fellowship with other Christians, but also they would remember and think about what they learned from your word. And we thank you for all the leaders who've given up their time. We pray that they would have a good rest after the busyness of camp. And we just pray for all the other ventures that will be going on over the coming weeks. Would you bless each one and use each one, especially in the young people's lives. And we pray for ourselves as a church. We pray that over these coming years, we would be able to encourage more young people to join in with these sort of activities, to learn from them and to enjoy them. And we pray all these things in the Lord Jesus' name. Amen. We now have James to lead us in some more prayers, especially about things that have happened in our country over the past week.
Let us pray. Father God, we pray for the three children who lost their lives in Southport. May your love and peace rest on their family, friends, and community. And may your justice be done. Father God, we pray for those who have been through painful, traumatic situations and who are now recovering physically and mentally. Help them to put the past behind them and be a guide, Lord, to all those who've gone through terrible ordeals. Lord, help us to keep to your ways and not stray off the narrow path. Take away the anger, resentment, and desire for revenge, which would only lead us into a dark abyss of sin and despair. Lord, fill us with your love and desire to do good, because only love conquers evil. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
So today's reading is from Mark chapter 10 and verses 17 to 31. And it's the incident when the rich man comes to see Jesus. And I'm filming it with the blue sky of Cumbria up above as our background today. Mark chapter 10, starting at verse 17. As Jesus started on his way, a man ran up to him and fell on his knees before him. "Good teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "Why do you call me good?" Jesus answered. "No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony. You shall not defraud. Honour your father and mother." "Teacher," he declared, "all these I have kept since I was a boy." Jesus looked at him and loved him. "One thing you lack," he said. "Go, sell everything you have and give to the poor. And you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me." At this, the man's face fell. He went away sad because he had great wealth. Jesus looked round and said to his disciples, "How hard it is for the rich to enter the kingdom of God." The disciples were amazed at his words. But Jesus said again, "Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God." The disciples were even more amazed and said to each other, "Who then can be saved?" Jesus looked at them and said, "With man this is impossible, but not with God. All things are possible with God." Then Peter spoke up, "We have left everything to follow you." "Truly I tell you," Jesus replied, "no one who has left home or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for me and the gospel will fail to receive 100 times as much in this present age, homes, brothers, sisters, mothers, children and fields, along with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last first." So we take a moment or two to look at this really interesting incident when Jesus meets this rich man, when this rich man comes up to Jesus and starts talking to him. And it's very much part of the journey that Jesus is taking to Jerusalem. We read right at the beginning of the passage, "as Jesus started on his way," or literally "as Jesus started on his road." He's on the road to Jerusalem and he's meeting people on the way. But this incident is one that often causes people to ask questions. There's a couple of things in it that puzzle people, and I guess I had to think about them again. You may have been noticed them being puzzled by them as you heard it being read. And the first of those, the biggest of those really, is when Jesus asked this man to give up all his wealth. It seems a bit of an unreasonable request, doesn't it? Too hard to do. And it's certainly not the way Jesus treats every rich person he meets. When he met Zacchaeus, well, Zacchaeus had his life turned around. You can read that in Luke chapter 19. Zacchaeus had his life turned around. Zacchaeus totally changed the way he used his wealth. But Jesus didn't ask him to give it up, or to give up all of it the way he asked this rich man. So what's going on here? And then maybe secondly, the other puzzle is the way that Jesus says, gets engaged in a conversation with this man about keeping the commandments, about doing things in order to enter God's kingdom, to be part of God's kingdom. And in the Bible, in the New Testament, it is very much focused on how salvation, being part of God's kingdom, is a gift from God. There's nothing that we can do to earn that. And why does Jesus get into this conversation with this man that seems to assume that a place in God's kingdom can be earned? Well, we're going to maybe, hopefully, think about those couple of questions as we go through and talk a bit more about the meaning of this passage. As Jesus was on his way, verse 17, a man ran up to him and fell on his knees before him. "Good teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Well, as we think about this, there are some clues that we get that come from where this passage is and some of the things that we've read around this story. As we went through, you may have heard certain resonances with some of the other things that we've said over the last couple of weeks. That phrase right at the end of Jesus' teaching after he meets the man, "But many who are first will be last, and the last first." That's very similar to something that we've heard before. The talk about following Jesus very much picks up on what he was teaching Peter and the other disciples right at the beginning of the journey. Right at the start of this incident, we need to notice that it comes straight after Jesus' teaching about the children that we heard last week in Hannah's talk. In fact, verse 15 of this chapter 10 says, "Truly I tell you, anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it." It talks about receiving the kingdom of God like a child. Like a child who's willing to receive things as a gift. And as we read that, we realise there's such a contrast with this young man who comes to Jesus, this rich young man who comes to Jesus. He comes to Jesus and asks, "What must I do to inherit the eternal life or to enter God's kingdom? What must I do?" Here's someone who is confident in his own ability to do things, to get on God's good side, to enter God's kingdom, to gain eternal life. What must I do? I think Jesus' conversation with him over keeping the commandments and so on is to try and draw out from the man an understanding that he is very far short of doing things that will earn a place in God's kingdom. It's not possible to do because we're just not good enough to do that. And so Jesus asks what commands he understands by the commandments, and he says he's been keeping these commandments since he was a boy. He keeps the sort of outwardly some of the moral commandments about how we should treat other people. Jesus doesn't mention the commandment about having no other gods but the Lord God, because he draws out the fact that this young man does have another god, really. That's why he asks him to give away his great wealth, to bring out the fact that actually this man does love something more than God. Yes, he's got great respect for Jesus. He comes and falls on his knees before Jesus. And Jesus recognizes that. Jesus looks at him and loves him before he asks him to give away all that he has. And he says to him, "Go sell everything you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. and then come follow me. That's Mark chapter 10, verse 21. This young man doesn't understand what it means to love God with all that he has, to have no other gods before the Lord God. He doesn't understand what it means to come and follow Jesus. Not really. Because following Jesus is the way that we show that we have no other gods. And Jesus said to his disciples, if you remember, back in Mark chapter 8, after Peter says, yes, you're the Messiah, after Peter then says, but you shouldn't go to the cross, you shouldn't go to Jerusalem, Jesus says, calls his disciples and the crowd and says, Mark chapter 8, verse 34, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves, take up their cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses their life for me and for the gospel will save it. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world, yet forfeit his soul? And this is what this young man is in danger of doing. Holding on to all that he has, holding on to the whole world, and yet not wanting to follow Jesus. And following Jesus will mean, like Jesus used the example of the children, being able to receive as a gift the thing that this man's looking for, a place in God's kingdom, eternal life, salvation. Those are all words that are used here for the same things, similar terms. And of course, at this, the man's face fell, verse 22. He went away sad, for he had great wealth. It was just too much for him, at least at this stage in his life, to leave that aside and to follow Jesus. We don't know what happened to the young man. This parting is a very sad one. Jesus looks at him and loves him and shows him the way to God's kingdom. He goes away sad because he loves his great wealth. And I guess our hope is that later in life he reflected on that and changed his mind. But at this point he won't come on the road with Jesus, the road to Jerusalem, the road that his disciples were going along. And just at that point, Jesus looks around and says to his disciples how hard it is for the rich to enter the kingdom of God. And the rich are outwardly blessed by God, aren't they? They've many good things. And yet Jesus is saying that it's difficult for them to come to God's kingdom. And the disciples are amazed at Jesus' words. And he uses this picture. It's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God. The camel was the biggest animal that those in Jesus's country would normally see. It's the biggest animal you would see on the streets. The eye of the needle is obviously one of the smallest things you would see. And so this is a humorous picture. How could you squeeze a huge big camel through the eye of a needle? And impossible for humans, we would say, and the disciples say. Who then can be saved, the disciples say? Jesus just answers, with man this is impossible, but not with God. All things are possible with God. And of course, rich and poor came to know Jesus. Little children and rich men, rich adults as well, all sorts of people. It's all possible with God. People do receive God's kingdom like a child would, and do come and follow Jesus, leaving all that they have behind. It is possible, Jesus says, because it's possible with God. And through the ages, many rich people have come to know Jesus. They've changed how they use their wealth. Their lives have been turned round, but it's been possible with God. And at the end of the passage, Jesus says, but many who are first will be last, and the last first. The rich man, I guess, one of those people who, if they walked into church, people would get excited. He would be shown a good seat. You would hope that he was going to come and become a regular, someone who was well known within the community, someone who was respected, someone who would bring a bit of money into the church finances. And yet, that's not what interests Jesus, is it? He welcomes rich people, but he knows that it's going to be hard for them to set aside their wealth as what's most important in their lives and truly follow him. And so someone who is first in society becomes, if you like, last in Jesus's kingdom. Jesus changes things round, changes lives round, and can enable any of us, rich or poor, through God's power, to be part of his kingdom, to know his salvation, and to have eternal life with him. Let's pray that many, rich and poor, will do that even in these days. We're going to sing a song that reminds us that it's not what we do that matters in God's kingdom. It's what we allow Jesus to do through us. It's all dependent on God's grace, on God's goodness. That's what this rich man needed to come to see. The chorus, so this song starts, "What gift of grace?" It finishes each verse with, "Yet not I, but through Christ in me." It's one I don't think we've used online before, but it's a great modern hymn that many people really like, and Rachel's recorded for us. Let's enjoy it together.
Sure, the price it has been paid.
Well, thank you for joining us today. Part of the service filmed from a sunny northern location in England. And thank you for joining in our summer camp special. Hope you've enjoyed it and learned from it. As I've been encouraged by finding out a bit more about what happens on these summer camps and ventures. And if there's anything you want to ask about that or about our teaching from Mark's Gospel, especially that incident when Jesus met rich man, please do get in touch. mark.gtclacton@gmail.com. We've just sung a modern hymn, which I think is a wonderful modern hymn, which each chorus says it's not yet I, but through Christ in me, reminding us that all that we can do in our lives, all we can do in our Christian lives, is only because the Lord Jesus is working in us. The rich young man had to learn that everything depended on God's grace. And so we're going to sing as we finish of that amazing grace that can only come from God. Let's sing together as Rachel leads us. Amazing grace.
Our final prayer today, taken from the end of the book of Hebrews. May the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, may he equip you with everything good for doing his will, and may he work in you what is pleasing to him, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.